And some of you have read the book, and some of you have read at least one story from the book, and I really appreciate that. And so I'm going to read something out of here, a last-minute decision, I think. And but I wanted to tell you that this is a collection of stories that are linked by the central character, whose name is Ray Fielding. And we meet him when he's 17 years old, and the stories cover about 20 years of his life, 20 or so years. And I think that, you know, as Kelly said, he gets married very young. The story he referenced, Honeymoon, is not what I'm going to read. I'm going to read a story that follows that one in the sequence. All these stories sort of, you know, cohere to create a kind of a novel-like sense, and I'd like for these stories to be read individually and have their own discrete value. But I'd like to also think that the value accrues to each story in proximity to the others, you know. But anyway, you're going to just get one in isolation today. It's called Gifted. So Ray got married when he's like 18 years old, right out of high school, to a high school sweetheart. Here we go. Marie saw something in me, I guess, but it wasn't what I thought she was paying attention to. I thought she liked my ardent love for her. That was nearly all I knew of myself. But what she saw must have been something I failed to develop sufficiently, some promise of what she could love about me, a mystery. We were too young. Everybody said so, except us. We should be together, she said. Why should we be apart, I said. My father cried at the wedding. First time I'd seen that. So many people cried. Imagine a young couple recently graduated from high school, beautifully dressed at the altar of the church, terrified and bewildered not just by their commitment to each other, but by the tears of their parents and other relatives. Embarrassed, the bride and groom look at each other and laugh, showing the hopeless youth that has so moved and frightened the grown-ups. This before the vows had even begun. Tears during the recessional, but smiles at the reception. Lots of weak congratulations and resigned advice. I wasn't even old enough to legally drink the champagne. Marie and I had graduated in June, and now it was September. It was 2 weeks after my 18th birthday. Marie had turned 20 in April. We were toasted and wished every happiness. My father pulled me aside and said, ominously, "A woman can be satisfied with love only so long." He looked me in the eye and nodded meaningfully, but I didn't know what he meant. He would be dead in 2 years, but not before Marie and I divorced. My mother's brother, Uncle Algernon, explained domestic happiness to me. With your Aunt Luann and me, whoever sees that something needs to be done just does it. Taking out the trash, washing the dishes or laundry, cooking or cleaning, doesn't matter. Washing the car, mowing the lawn, whatever. We get along great, 30 years. Uncle Dale, my father's brother, found me as I came out of the bathroom. He walked me back into the hotel ballroom and slipped me an envelope containing $50. He said, "Don't ever screw one of our friends." Next to money, the biggest cause of trouble. I looked across the rose-colored carpet of white-gowned Marie, surrounded by her bridesmaids in pale blue and her mother in royal blue, and wondered what advice she was getting. Who could know? I doubted it was anything like I'd heard, most of which I felt I shouldn't share with her. That well-meaning counsel already was a secret separating us. We had an apartment, an upstairs one-bedroom room with a long hallway leading to a sunny, spacious kitchen in a section of town between our parents' neighborhoods. Because we had no money, we got good financial aid to college, and I went to Central during the day and then worked nights at the country club. Marie had a job admitting patients at the hospital and took night classes at Carolina. We paid our rent, had a little leftover for food, and depending on my tips, we could decorate around our donated and flea market furniture with plants and rugs, or picnic at Carr Lake, go to a movie. Before we were married, we used to read to each other over the phone from books that we liked. Mostly, Marie liked to visit. On Sundays after church, which I seldom attended on the excuse that I worked until 2 in the morning, we would go to her parents' house or to mine or to the home of old folk friends of hers. people I barely knew. They called me Gray or Roy instead of Ray, and called Marie, Mary, or Maggie, close enough. We sat in their living rooms and drank Coke or tea, ate stale cake or chips. Often we'd stop first at the grocery store and buy a cluster of flowers for them, and at our next visit the flowers would be dry and dead, still in the vase Marie had put them in. The visits had charm, but I never wanted to go. I wanted to rest at home with Marie, watch a game with her. That was a problem. Little I wanted reflected well on me. But who could fault Marie for wanting to cheer up old people? We spent so little time together that whatever we had in common we couldn't nourish, while she at least was having her passion for science and medicine steadily fed, subjects I cared about only because Marie did. We had mornings, young husband in sunny kitchen slicing pink grapefruit and brewing coffee in one of two Mr. Coffees giving at the wedding. Oatmeal, toast, and bacon. Young wife, sleepy and beautiful in the morning light, wants an egg. She puts ketchup on that egg. Marie, he asked, exaggerating revulsion, how did you learn that ketchup might enhance an egg? Bad for me, but good too. Mmm, she smiles, a sugar jolt, a gory plate. Of his oatmeal with butter, she says, you're defeating the purpose of oatmeal, Ray. High cholesterol is the leading cause of heart disease and stroke, especially among black males. You need to live a long time. What about your eggs, he says. Only 3 yolks a week, the safe limit. But oatmeal's awful without something. There's nothing we can eat. Sure there is. She's pre-med, taking a nutrition class. The soy thing, tofu. He makes a face. He misses his mother's fried chicken. Marie's shoulders shine in the sun through windows framed by white curtains, curtains with eyelet flowers embroidered in pink, yellow, green. Her suppleness when he encircles her waist and pulls her close. Maybe he could eat tofu. We seldom had an evening meal together. It was cheaper for me to eat at the country club for free, save on the grocery bill. Marie often went to her mother's or ate spaghetti alone in our kitchen, at our kitchen dinette while she studied before heading off to UNC. I studied in the library between classes, fraternized with busboys and other waiters at the country club, tried to do homework there. I was that guy then, deflecting both praise and criticism when found reading a book, absorbing the interest of people I served who wanted to know about me and placidly accepting my invisibility to the others. Marie and I both missed the ball games, concerts, step shows, and extracurricular lectures. But after Marie's classes, there were sometimes those who didn't want to go home, and Marie eventually accepted invitations to grab coffee. Her teacher often led those groups, her academic advisor. What he saw, smart and gorgeous and smart. The teacher hated going home. He was going through a divorce. Marie won an Outstanding Freshman Award given by the biology department. This was 3 weeks before her birthday. To celebrate all of it, I invited our families, her professor, a few of her friends, some old folks, and my coworker, Romeo. He said his mother named him. He would tell me about his recent year-long adventures in Mexico, Morocco, and London, where he claimed to have waited tables, played in bands, and survived as a gigolo. I thought he'd be funny to Marie, as he was to me. He had dark, chin-length hair that fell across his face in a wave, and he traded on his racial and sexual ambiguity, flirting with both female and male patrons at the restaurant, and all the staff, black and white, Asian and Indian. Many people came nightly just to be served by him. He was black and straight, I think, but for everybody he flashed his white teeth and swept back his wave of hair. I liked him. He didn't brag about his tips. I invited Marie's professor so I could get a look at him, and because he had nominated her for the award. It shouldn't have shocked me to see he was white, but it did. I don't think she knew yet that I was jealous of him. Anyway, she talked about him constantly. She found it sad that his wife had moved to Wisconsin with their children. She admired his focus, his talent for teaching, and his encouraging counsel. It wasn't a surprise party, but I wouldn't let Marie do anything to help. My mother was doing the cooking, and Marie's mother was baking a cake. But when I came home the night before, ready to tidy the apartment, I found Marie had already swept the floors and vacuumed the rugs. There were fresh hand towels in the bathroom and potpourri in a small bowl on the toilet tank, and votive candles on the sink, the living room tables, and the dresser in the bedroom. On the bed, Marie had opened school books and dresses from the closet. She had been cleaning and studying and now deciding what she would wear. I thought I was going to do the cleaning, I said. You can still clean the oven, she said, and mop the kitchen. It was past midnight. I had planned to bring the kitchen to an all-around shine when Marie went to church in the morning. Everybody would be heading here after church. I hadn't thought about the oven. Marie held up a peach-colored sundress. It still had the store tags on it, and I remembered when we had bought it on sale during the fall. Marie looked good in all the clothes she wore, but I was especially fond of her dresses and blouses that bared her shoulders. I like that one. You finally get to wear it, I said. I pushed some books aside and lay down in the bed. It was a four-poster bed we bought at a flea market and lacked a canopy. Tonight at work, one of the older waiters had talked to me about working for him in the business he was starting. He was putting together a team of waiters to contract out the hotels in the Triangle for banquet service. I mentioned this to Marie, that it could mean more money, especially if I started gradually, worked with him when I could, and then maybe, if he looked secure enough, quit the country club. Marie didn't say anything at first. She was standing in the closet, her back to me, and I wondered if she had heard me. Then she said, "Waiting tables is waiting tables." "I know," I studied her back. She had on cut-off sweatpants and a t-shirt, but this guy's black. "So?" She turned to face me. She looked annoyed. Maybe she was tired. Maybe she felt stressed. She wasn't showing any excitement about the party. "So it might be more comfortable working for a black man for a change, and it wouldn't hurt to help a brother get a business going." "Why does the brother have to have a waiter business?" "I don't know, Marie. I mean, he's worked at the club for maybe 20 years. I guess it's the work he knows." "That's the problem, Ray." She gathered up a group of dresses from the bed and hugged them to her chest. "He's carrying on the tradition of black people as America's servant class. It's as though the only businesses we can start are the butler business and the shoeshine business. Besides mutual and the bank, everything else is a barbecue joint or a t-shirt kiosk. You're talking about a guy who's figured out how to get paid to be the boss house slave." "Jesus, Marie." I'd never heard her speak so critically. She hung a few dresses in the closet. "You can do better, Ray," she said. "I'm trying to do better. That's what I'm talking about. I don't have time to do better than better." She stared at me a while as if thinking that over. Then she turned to hang up more clothes. "I guess you don't want me to take the job," I said. She sighed. "I guess I don't care, Ray. As I said, waiting tables is waiting tables. But damn," I said, "it's not like I'm the one starting the business. I'm just trying to afford to live." I got off the bed and went into the kitchen to look at the oven. My mother would be using it to warm the party food. I took out the racks and sprayed the inside with cleaner. Then I mopped the kitchen floor, waited for it to dry, and waxed it. By the time I was finished, Marie was asleep. I hoped she would feel better in the morning. I hoped I would. I showered and slipped into bed. I inhaled the chemical stench of floor wax until I went to sleep. In the afternoon, Marie came home from church with her parents. My parents came next with trays and pots of food. Two of the old couples arrived together, and Romeo showed up at the same time as two of Marie's girlfriends. Marie's professor arrived late, and Marie and her mother promptly moved to make him feel welcome. He wore a red polo shirt and pleated khakis. His hair was brown with blonde streaks. He was in his 30s, shorter than me, but with a broad chest and stance. He carried a wrapped gift for Marie, yet the women fussed over him as if he were the honored one. The small apartment was packed, people in our living room, camped in the bedroom, and hanging out in the kitchen. My mother gave him a plate of turkey, corn, and collard greens. "Here you are, Professor. Have a seat at the table." She gave him the place where she'd been sitting. The table sat only four. "Thank you. This all looks great. Please call me Jack," he said. Marie, her mother, and my mother gathered around him while my father and father-in-law went down the back stairs to smoke. I don't think Romeo was used to competition for female attention. He seemed no match for the professor. I got us a couple of beers and we stood and watched the talk for a while. The mothers took turns eliciting praise for Marie and finally got to asking Jack about himself. "I grew up near Chicago," he said, his voice nasal and tenor. "I did my doctoral work at Princeton and I've taught at North Carolina 4 years. "Are you tenured?" my mother asked. A teacher herself at the community college, she knew the important credential. "Not yet," he smiled. "I apply next year. I've co-authored the book and it will be published by then, and hopefully students like Marie will keep making me look good." We're really proud of her, Marie's mother said, and we're tremendously grateful for you for what you've done for her. He chuckled. About all I've done is be amazed. I hope my daughters will grow up as talented as Marie. They live with their mother, and I miss them. They're 6 and 3. You're lucky to have had Marie her whole life. We're lucky Marie is even alive, her mother said. You know about her cancer recovery? Mom, Marie said, I told him, but let's not talk about that. I just want him to know you're not just smart, you're strong, too, a survivor. I hope your daughters are as special as Marie, too, Professor. Ray, would you get Professor Rigsby some tea, Marie asked. Sure. These were the first words she'd spoken to me since he arrived. My mother said, I'm so sorry. Where's my mind? I should have gotten that for you. That's all right, said the professor. I didn't get thirsty until just now. These greens are delicious. But there are plenty more. We saved some just for you, my mother said. Marie's mother asked, do you live near here, Professor? Call me Jack, please, Mrs. Hargrove. I live in Hillsboro, but you know, everything is close around these parts. Romeo, sitting on a stool near the sink, said, I like that little town. Didn't Daniel Boone used to live there, or was it Davy Crockett? I don't know about that, Jack said. He lifted cream corn to his lips and then looked at Marie sitting across from him. I should have the class over for a get-together, huh? Have a bonfire or something, speaking of blazing trails. Romeo slipped out of the kitchen. I took the trash down to the back steps to the dumpster. Down there, I stood with the smokers who sat on lawn chairs in the little patch of yard between the apartment house and the fence that shielded the parking ground. Since the wedding, neither my dad nor Mr. Hargrove had stopped giving me advice on everything from birth control to how to carve a turkey. I hoped for some more advice from them, something useful for the moment. Jack Rigsby could give Marie academic prizes and prestige. What could I give her? Nothing but love. I wondered about Jack's feelings for his absent wife and children. How could he seem so content with that loss? My father, a big man, stood and clapped me on the shoulder. Nice party, he said. Thanks to Mom, I said. You put it together, Mr. Hargrove said. You young fellows know how to be thoughtful. Brenda's always complaining that I'm not thoughtful. I should do something nice for her, but I can't think of what. He pinched off the burning end of his short cigarette and put the filter into the brown eyeglass case clipped in his checked shirt pocket. My father said, you're considered thoughtful if you take your wife on a cruise, buy her diamond earrings, buy her flowers, buy her stuff. That's just rich, Mr. Hargrove said. I wish Beverly just liked to do what I like to do, my father said. I wish she liked to fish. If she could learn the beauty of a rainbow trout on a sunny lake, I'd be a happier man. Right now, Mr. Hargrove said, they're all liking that white professor. Well, women do like a professor, Dad said. They like a doctor and they like a soldier. They like a singer, too. I think they like a singer the most. Don't forget a preacher. But I was a soldier, Mr. Hargrove said. I got that at least. I can't even claim that, Dad said. Good thing I'm so good-looking, I guess. The professor is kind of good-looking, too, Mr. Hargrove. Mr. Hargrove looked at me and laughed a little. He can't sing, can he? I hope not, I said. They both laughed. My father said, you get all the points today, son. When you were born, your mother acted like she was in love with her obstetrician, all for delivering you safely, hugging him big time every time she saw him, gushing about how he saved you. You had that cord around your neck, you know. Even your first name is his last name. That's a coincidence, sort of, but one she values a lot. Made me jealous, but she never forgot how you really got to be here, if you know what I mean. He winked at Mr. Hargrove, then arched his eyebrows at me. Thanks, Dad, I think, I said. Mr. Hargrove said, it's always strange when a white man's in the house. That OB is black, Dad said, if that's what you're getting at. Then I thought about my talk with Marie the night before. I hadn't had a chance yet to talk with Dad about possibly changing jobs, and I wondered if he'd ever faced similar disapproval from Mom. He was half retired from managing the house of a wealthy white family. He started as a chauffeur, driving their kids to and from school when they were young, but then started seeing to the gardeners and the general maintenance of the house. I knew Mom used to resent the time he spent with that family. He even went on vacations with them to their beach and mountain homes. But has she belittled him for the work? Maybe. I didn't want to ask about it now in front of Mr. Hargrove, who owned a gas station. I once got in a fight with a kid who called my dad house slave. And Dad used to seem a little too proud of coming home in his boss's new station wagon or Cadillac. I used to resent his boss's kids that he drove around in those cars. I wasn't planning on serving white people indefinitely. Marie needed to give me a break. Inside, the professor was eating coconut cake. I had thought we were saving that for when Marie opened her gifts, when we would sing Happy Birthday. I kept going in and out of the kitchen, cutting my eye at Marie, who looked at me blandly as I passed. Maybe she at least wondered what I was doing. I was singing to the other guests, making sure the old folks had something to drink, and I was trying to seem interested in what Jack Rigsby had to say, trying to share Marie's appreciation for him. In the bedroom, I found Romeo eating cake with Marie's girlfriends. All three sat on the bed. Ballroom dancing was on the television. Ray, he said, tell these ladies that I'm the king of the tango. No, don't tell us, one of the girls said. This was Karen, whom I didn't like much, but Marie had known her since kindergarten. And at our rehearsal dinner, she asked me what gave me the most pleasure of all the arts, and I said music. She said to Marie, guys his age always say music. She was skinny and chinless and probably envious, trying to instigate something. You tango? I asked Romeo. I do, Romeo said. Do you? He asked the girls. I do not, Karen said. The other, Lena, another childhood friend, leaned into him. You look like a mambo man to me. Mambo, yes, and I can teach you to tango as I learned it in Buenos Aires. It's more than teaching you to dance, it's teaching you to be danced. Karen rolled her eyes. Lena said, do I really have to be helpless? No, Romeo said, you have to be trusting. I left Romeo to his audience. In the living room, two old women sat on the sofa with plates of cake on their laps. There were Mrs. Jenkins and Mrs. Clay. Their husbands sat opposite them on scavenged chairs. Mrs. Clay's eyeglasses were so smudged, I doubted she could see who I was. Along with some other gifts, Marie's present from her professor was still on the coffee table in front of them. It was wrapped in shiny blue paper and shaped like a pen and pencil set, but it could have been something more personal, like a bracelet or a necklace. It was hard to know what a professor would think was appropriate for his favorite student, as if giving her the Outstanding Achievement Award wasn't enough. How would you like to hear some music? I asked the old ladies. Oh, that would be nice, Mrs. Jenkins says. Sure would. Nice, said Mrs. Clay. I knelt at the bookcase before the shelf with records and found the Donny Hathaway LP. If women liked a singer, then I would give them one. As I slipped the record from its sleeve, my dream of the night before came back to me. I forgot I had dreamed it. I had been standing on the dark interior staircase of my high school, crying. It was a variation of a recurring dream I had had since I met Marie. I would be at school, in the media center, on the grounds, on the stairs, looking for her, feeling confused about whether or not she was even a student at the school, panicking in aggravated expectation. But in the last dream, I wasn't afraid. I was on the stairs, crying so hard, water flooded the stairwell. Donny Hathaway's voice sounded extraordinarily soulful and both sealed and soothed that dreamed grief. I smiled at the old women eating their cake and they nodded their approval of the music. I went to the bathroom to be alone a moment, to take a breath for the rest of the day. But I walked in on Romeo, who was sniffing the tip of a fingernail file. Shit, he said, flashing his smile. Doesn't that lock work? Jesus, Romeo, what are you doing? I shut the door fast and locked it right. Smack, want some? He held out a small bag of white powder. No, thanks, that's heroin? Yeah, just a snort. I wouldn't shoot it in your bathroom, man. You look like you could use some, mellow you out, take your mind off how boring your party is. No offense, man, I know it has to be this way, but all these old folks and that white dude, even those chicks in there are lame. Anybody could have caught you, Romeo. Marie would have a fit. It's cool, Ray, only you caught me. He laughed. Sorry about the lock, though. He closed the bag and put away the nail file. He wiped his nose. All right, I'm grabbing another brew then. After he left, I rinsed the sink and splashed water on my face. My face felt a little numb. I'd already had one beer too many. I needed to finish the party. Christ, I didn't know Romeo was into heroin. I hollered down the back steps for Dad and Mr. Hargrove to come in. I gathered everybody in the living room and sat Marie on the sofa between the old ladies. And my father and I made sure everybody had a glass of champagne. Romeo had a beer in one hand and his champagne glass in the other. He was grinning, showing his dazzling teeth. "You have a beautiful face," he said to Marie. She blushed with embarrassment, but then held her face up and grinned back at him. "I made a toast to my darling wife, wishing her a happy birthday, and predicted for her a brilliantly successful medical career." Then her father said some words about his pride in her and grew teary-eyed as he recalled what she had overcome already, her illness, and what she still had to overcome. I took that last as a reference to her being married at so young an age to me. But maybe he just meant finishing college, getting into med school, becoming a doctor. He and I got along all right. I lifted my camera and snapped a shot of her beaming at him. Then the professor raised his glass. "Marie is a fresh breeze among students," he said. "Her insatiable curiosity, impeccable preparedness, and beautiful spirit make her a bona fide star, and like you, Ray, I predict superb things for her." "Hear, hear," my father said. In the background, under the spatter of applause, Donny Hathaway began singing, "To be young, gifted, and black," softly and reverently. Marie opened her presents and held them up for the room to see and exclaim over. Her friends Lena and Karen gathered up the wrapping paper as Marie ripped it from the boxes. It seemed odd hearing that special song with Professor Rigsby in the room. While I didn't want him to feel excluded, it made him seem all the more like an intrusion. But I was glad it was playing now. The timing was perfect, as I had wanted to play it for Marie, who was all of the things the song was about. She smiled at me, which took me by surprise. She was happy, and I was glad I'd planned the party. She opened the professor's gift, a pen and pencil set made of sleek wood with her name engraved on the sides, and she looked at him with the softest expression of appreciation I could imagine. It was an expression that he mirrored. Suddenly, I felt as if I were dreaming awake. I felt prophetic. I felt the ache of our future. I could hear her say, "Ray, we need to talk. This was a mistake, and you know it. After all, what did we really have in common?" She wanted a professor or a banker or a physician, and I didn't have faith that I'd ever be other than a waiter. Yet for the moment, I had something going for me. I was celebrated too by the song. I was certainly young and certainly black, and I felt I had the greatest gift in Marie. The end. Well, thank you guys for that applause. Yeah. So that's all I think I plan to read, but maybe you have some questions you'd like to ask about either that story or something else about the book or anything about writing. Yeah.
Yeah, so this book is a linked short story. So like when you have like this character, Ray, like, do you become attached to him in a different way than you have like when you only write a singular story?
Yeah, it is. I mean, I hadn't done that before, you know. I mean, I chose this form because I had never followed a single character through a long period of time, you know, in his life, you know. And I'd never really written a proper novel either, you know. And so my idea was to avoid feeling intimidated by the prospect of writing a novel, I thought I would write stories about the same guy and then see how they linked up later, you know, figure out how to link them up later. And it freed me from having to follow the character day to day. I could just follow him sort of, you know, decade to decade, you know, and so to speak. And but yeah, I did become attached to him in a way that I felt I got bored with him because I thought he sometimes, you know, because he wouldn't ever be, he couldn't get out of, he felt like a loser to me sometimes, you know, and I wanted to try to write him out of that, some, you know, and that was difficult to do sometimes. It felt difficult. But I'm glad I wrote it, you know, and I like the book. I like the way it turned out. It kind of feels lucky that it turned out in a way that I like. Are there other questions or another one? I had a lot of questions today in class. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I was just going to say, in case you don't ask any more questions, I've already answered a lot from
yeah, I was just
going to
ask, like, what was the Yeah, so in your comment that he started kind of, you said the character started feeling like a bit of a loser to you.
Yes.
Do you go into writing, you first kind of started to build the character, were you trying to characterize him as that, or kind of like modest, or just kind of on its own started going too far in that direction when you felt that he'd bring back? Or?
Yeah, on its own it went in that direction. I mean, I know he was going to be heartbroken early on, you know? But how do you come back from that, you know, even in real life, you know? And so it was hard to write him out of that in a way, you know? So I had to create new characters for him to be involved in and create other scenarios for him to have to deal with where he wasn't just preoccupied with what he had lost, you know? Yeah. Well, if there aren't any more, okay. Oh, one more. Yeah.
I'm curious about what the process of coming up with the title was.
Well, yeah, thank you. It's the title of his business. He grows up to actually have the business that he is describing to Marie that his coworker wants to begin, you know? So he grows up and takes that idea and creates it for himself and calls it Triangle Ray, you know, contracting serving staff to hotels in the Research Triangle area, you know? And so the Research Triangle area is this sort of like the Quiet Cities here. It's a group of three towns, Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill in North Carolina, and it forms a triangle, and there's a industrial park called the Research Triangle, you know, sort of in the middle of all of that, and where these hotels are, you know? So I called it Triangle Ray, first of all, to honor the setting of the triangle in North Carolina. And then it's the title of his business. But then also, it turned, you know, he's got these, it's a triangle relationship between, well, it's him and it's Marie, and then there's Alma, this other woman that comes into his life after this story I just read to you. Originally, I was hoping that I could embed the stories with multiple iterations of triangle relationships, you know, and that didn't quite pan out, you know, the way I planned, you know. But there's one story that I mentioned in class today. He has a friend named Dexter later in his life, and Dexter's married to a woman that Ray becomes infatuated with. So it's a triangle relationship, but only Ray knows about it, you know? You know, it's a secret to his best friend and to his best friend's wife. You know? Yeah. So, and that's other little, maybe you may find some other triangles in there, but they may be also purely accidental. Yeah. Yes?
I was struck by the dialogue in the story. So can you say a little bit about how you develop that skill and what you think about when you're writing dialogue?
Yeah, I just try to make it sound kind of natural and try to get some jokes in there when I can, you know. It's just a matter of listening and trying to just hear how people might sound in my head, you know, and hope it shows up on the page that way. When I was reading it just now, it felt like the dialogue felt a little bland to me, you know, and I was tempted to rush through it, you know, but it's gratifying to hear you say something that might that mean you liked it, you know. I like to eavesdrop, you know, on, you know, I'll be at a diner and listen, I'll listen to the people in at the booth behind me, you know, and just sort of hear their voices, and often, if I hear something provocative enough or interesting enough, I'll want to put that in a story, you know, put that line in a story, and that's, sometimes that's how stories are born, so to speak, you know. I say I need to find a way to showcase this line, so I have to come up with something other than a guy sitting in a booth eavesdropping on the people behind, you know. I have to have a reason for a character to say this, you know, and then I have to make up a situation where that might be said, you know. So I think, you know, that's a good, I would advise that, you know, eavesdrop on people and then take notes, you know. Yes, sir.
So you figured that you would write a bunch of short stories and see how they, how you can kind of connect them. Did mm-hmm. did you do so sequentially though, like to follow this lifeline, or did you put it together later?
Yeah, some of them were sequential, others were not. There was a point where I got tired of writing about Ray, and I would write another story that didn't seem to be about Ray, you know. And then when I saw the book really coming together, I said, well, maybe I can make Ray this main character, you know, just sort of figure out a way that the guy who was, you know, Bobby, you know, and one story, I just made him Ray, and I had to tinker with the story to so that his something about him would match the character from the other stories. And then when I also looked at the book and saw that there may be significant holes in the arc, would determine a story I needed to write to fill that space, you know. So it was a little bit of both, you know, sequential and then out of sequence and then rearranging, you know. I had to think about making sure that, you know, sometimes I was writing and felt like every story took place exactly at the same time as the other story, you know? And then I had to figure out a timeline, you know? Then I had to revise stories so that he would be a little older than he was the time before, and I had to sort of make him a calendar, you know? Like, this is what he did in this year, and then this year, and this year. Even though I don't necessarily name the year in each story, or name his age in each story, I had to, that was a struggle to understand who he was when, you know. Yeah. And felt like it wasn't gonna happen, you know, because it's a, well, you know, all this, everything happened in 1983, you know, right, you know, and so I had to stretch it out somehow, yeah. Well, I really appreciate your attention and your questions and, you know, not falling asleep at least. Mm-hmm. And thanks again for inviting me. I understand we're gonna have a little reception out here, you know, buy a book if you like, by 18, and I'll sign what you want me to. Right? So thanks again. Room in the media center, on the grounds, on the stairs, looking for her, feeling confused about whether or not she was even a student at the school, panicking in aggravated expectation. But in the last dream, I wasn't afraid. I was on the stairs, crying so hard, water flooded the stairwell. Donny Hathaway's voice sounded extraordinarily soulful and both sealed and soothed that dreamed grief. I smiled at the old women eating their cake, and they nodded their approval of the music. I went to the bathroom to be alone a moment, to take a breath for the rest of the day. But I walked in on Romeo, who was sniffing the tip of a fingernail file. Shit, he said, flashing his smile. Doesn't that lock work? Jesus, Romeo, what are you doing? I shut the door fast and locked it right. Smack, want some? He held out a small bag of white powder. No, thanks, that's heroin? Yeah, just a snort. I wouldn't shoot it in your bathroom, man. You look like you could use some, mellow you out, take your mind off how boring your party is. No offense, man, I know it has to be this way, but all these old folks and that white dude, even those chicks in there are lame. Anybody could have caught you, Romeo. Marie would have a fit. It's cool, Ray, only you caught me. He laughed. Sorry about the lock, though. He closed the bag and put away the nail file. He wiped his nose. All right, I'm grabbing another brew then. After he left, I rinsed the sink and splashed water on my face. My face felt a little numb. I'd already had one beer too many. I needed to finish the party. Christ, I didn't know Romeo was into heroin. I hollered down the back steps for Dad and Mr. Hargrove to come in. I gathered everybody in the living room and sat Marie on the sofa between the old ladies. And my father and I made sure everybody had a glass of champagne. Romeo had a beer in one hand and his champagne glass in the other. He was grinning, showing his dazzling teeth. You have a beautiful face, he said to Marie. She blushed with embarrassment, but then held her face up and grinned back at him. I made a toast to my darling wife, wishing her a happy birthday, and predicted for her a brilliantly successful medical career. Then her father said some words about his pride in her and grew teary-eyed as he recalled what she had overcome already, her illness, and what she still had to overcome. I took that last as a reference to her being married at so young an age to me. But maybe he just meant finishing college, getting into med school, becoming a doctor. He and I got along all right. I lifted my camera and snapped a shot of her beaming at him. Then the professor raised his glass. Maria's a fresh breeze among students, he said. Her insatiable curiosity, impeccable preparedness, and beautiful spirit make her a bona fide star, and like you, Ray, I predict superb things for her. Hear, hear, my father said. In the background, under the spatter of applause, Donny Hathaway began singing, "To be young, gifted, and black," softly and reverently. Marie opened her presents and held them up for the room to see and exclaim over. Her friends Lena and Karen gathered up the wrapping paper as Marie ripped it from the boxes. It seemed odd hearing that special song with Professor Rigsby in the room. While I didn't want him to feel excluded, it made him seem all the more like an intrusion. But I was glad it was playing now. The timing was perfect, as I had wanted to play it for Marie, who was all of the things the song was about. She smiled at me, which took me by surprise. She was happy, and I was glad I'd planned the party. She opened the professor's gift, a pen and pencil set made of sleek wood with her name engraved on the sides, and she looked at him with the softest expression of appreciation I could imagine. It was an expression that he mirrored. Suddenly, I felt as if I were dreaming awake. I felt prophetic. I felt the ache of our future. I could hear her say, "Ray, we need to talk. This was a mistake and you know it. After all, what did we really have in common?" She wanted a professor or a banker or a physician, and I didn't have faith that I'd ever be other than a waiter. Yet for the moment, I had something going for me. I was celebrated too by the song. I was certainly young and certainly black, and I felt I had the greatest gift in Marie. The end. Okay. That applause, you know. So that's all I think I plan to read, but maybe you have some questions you'd like to ask about either that story or something else about the book or anything about writing. Yeah?
Yeah, so this book is linked.
Yes.
Linked short story. So like when you have like this character, Ray, like, do you become attached to him in a different way than you have like when you only write a singular story?
Yeah, it is. I mean, I hadn't done that before, you know. I mean, I chose this form because I had never followed a single character through a long period of time, you know, in his life, you know. And I'd never really written a proper novel either, you know. And so my idea was to avoid feeling intimidated by writing, you know, the prospect of writing a novel, I thought I would write stories about the same guy and then see how they linked up later, you know, figure out how to link them up later. And so it freed me from having to follow the character day to day. I could just follow him sort of, you know, decade to decade, you know, and so to speak. And but yeah, I did become attached to him in a way, and I felt I got bored with him because I thought he couldn't get out of, he felt like a loser to me sometimes, you know, and I wanted to try to write him out of that, some, you know, and that was difficult to do sometimes. It felt difficult. But I'm glad I wrote it, you know. I mean, I like the book. I like the way it turned out. It kind of feels lucky that it turned out in a way that I like. Are there other questions or another one? I had a lot of questions today in class. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I was just going to say, in case you don't ask any more questions, I've already answered a lot from you.
Yeah, so in your comment that he started kind of, you said the character started feeling like a bit of a loser to you.
Yes.
You go into writing, you first kind of started to build the character, were you trying to characterize him as that, or kind of like modest, or if it just kind of on its own started going too far in that direction when you felt the need to bring back? Or?
Yeah, on its own it went in that direction. I mean, I know he was going to be heartbroken early on, you know? You know, how do you come back from that, you know, even in real life, you know? And so it was hard to write him out of that in a way, you know? So I had to create new characters for him to be involved in and create other scenarios for him to have to deal with where he wasn't just preoccupied with what he had lost, you know? Yeah. Well, if there aren't any more, okay. Oh, one more. Yeah.
I'm curious about what the process of coming up with the title was.
Well, yeah, thank you. It's the title of his business. He grows up to actually have the business that he is describing to Marie that his coworker wants to begin, you know? So he grows up and takes that idea and creates it for himself and calls it Triangle Ray, you know, contracting serving staff to hotels in the Research Triangle area, you know? And so the Research Triangle area is this sort of like the Quiet Cities here. It's a group of three towns, Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill in North Carolina, and it forms a triangle, and there's a industrial park called the Research Triangle, you know, sort of in the middle of all of that, and where these hotels are, you know? So I called it Triangle Ray, first of all, to honor the setting of the triangle in North Carolina. And then it's the title of his business. But then also, it turned, you know, he's got these, it's a triangle relationship between, it's him and it's Marie, and then there's Alma, this other woman that comes into his life after this story I just read to you. Originally, I was hoping that I could embed the stories with multiple iterations of triangle relationships, you know, and that didn't quite pan out, you know, the way I planned, you know. But there's one story that I mentioned in class today. He has a friend named Dexter later in his life, and he, Dexter's married to a woman that Ray becomes infatuated with. So it's a triangle relationship, but only Ray knows about it, you know? You know, it's a secret to his best friend and to his best friend's wife. You know? Yeah. So, and that's other little, maybe you may find some other triangles in there, but they may be also purely accidental. Yeah. Yes?
I was struck by the dialogue in the story. So can you say a little bit about how you develop that skill and what you think about when you're writing dialogue?
Yeah, I just try to make it sound kind of natural and try to get some jokes in there when I can, you know. It's just a matter of listening and trying to just hear how people might sound in my head, you know, and hope it shows up on the page that way. When I was reading it just now, it felt like the dialogue felt a little bland to me, you know, and I was tempted to rush through it, you know, but it's gratifying to hear you say something that might that mean you liked it, you know. I like to eavesdrop, you know, on, you know, I'll be at a diner and I'll listen to the people in at the booth behind me, you know, and just sort of hear their voices. And and often, if I hear something provocative enough or interesting enough, I'll want to put that in a story, you know, put that line in a story, and that's, sometimes that's how stories are born, so to speak, you know. I need to find a way to showcase this line, so I have to come up with something other than a guy sitting in a booth eavesdropping on the people behind, you know. You know, I have to have a reason for a character to say this, you know, and then I have to make up a situation where that might be said, you know. So I think, you know, that's a good, I would advise that, you know, eavesdrop on people and then take notes, you know. Yes, sir.
So you figured that you would write a bunch of short stories and see how they, how you can kind of connect them. Did mm-hmm. did you do so sequentially though? Like to follow this lifeline, or did you put it together later?
Yeah, some of them were sequential. Others were not. There was a point where I got tired of writing about Ray, and I would write another story that didn't seem to be about Ray, you know? And then when I saw the book really coming together, I said, well, maybe I can make Ray this main character, you know, just sort of figure out a way that the guy who was, you know, Bobby, you know, and one story, I just made him Ray, and I had to tinker with the story to, so that his, something about him would match the character from the other stories. And then when I also looked at the book and saw that there may be significant holes in the arc, I would determine a story I needed to write to fill that space, you know. So it was a little bit of both, you know, sequential and then out of sequence and then rearranging, you know. I had to think about making sure that, you know, sometimes I was writing and felt like every story took place exactly at the same time as the other story, you know. And then I had to figure out a timeline, you know. Then I had to revise stories so that he would be a little older than he was the time before. And I had to sort of make him a calendar, you know, like this is what he did in this year and then this year and this year. Even though I don't necessarily name the year in each story or name his age in each story, I had to, that was a struggle to understand who he was when, you know. And felt like it wasn't gonna happen, you know, because it's a, well, you know, all this, everything happened in 1983, you know, right, you know, and so I had to stretch it out somehow, yeah. Well, I really appreciate your attention and your questions and, you know, not falling asleep, at least, but, you know, and thanks again for inviting me. I understand we're gonna have a little reception out here, you know. Buy a book if you like, by 18, and I'll sign what you want me to. Right? So thanks again. Yeah.